Hello, it's time for Thirsty Thursday, that time of the week where we hop on camera for a few minutes and talk about the hits, the misses, the things that everybody was thirsty for during the week. Something I just heard on the drive over here to Susan's this morning was that in Toronto, Dundas Street is going to be renamed. They just passed that in City Council.
Yeah.
So that means the subway stations, Yonge Dundas Square. Dundas is everywhere. It's a very well-known name. Tied to the history of the city of Toronto. The reason the rename's happening, for those of you who maybe aren't aware, is that Henry Dundas, he was a Scottish, back in the olden day timeies, he was someone who really was involved in the British transatlantic slave trade,
yeah.
Stalled the ceasing of it here in Canada.
Yeah.
So he's been very problematic as a historical figure for a while. There was a petition to change the name that started back in 2020, I think, and it's finally now happening. So come soon, there will be no more Dundas names spread across this city.
Yeah, and for some context for our non-Canadian listeners, this is a huge street that runs diagonally across the whole city of Toronto. There's so many businesses along that street that have variations of the name Dundas in it. Like, think about the maps and the apps and all of those things.
Yeah.
So 100%, I think it's a great decision that we're changing the name, but it'd be interesting to see how long. You'd also mentioned that there was some support for businesses that the city
they announced, because my first thing when I heard this was, this sounds wonderful, but I wonder, all those businesses that are called Dundas Variety, Dundas Pizza, there are so many businesses that are tied to the name Dundas. So the city did announce they're doing a committee and to talk about financial support for businesses and other people that are going to be affected by this rename, so that's good to know as well.
Yeah. Oh, well, so that's local here, and from there we're gonna hop across the pond and chat soccer or football. So after the Euro Cup final on Sunday this week, there was a lot of hate speech because it came to a penalty
shootout. Yeah.
And the three people who missed the goals on the English team were black players.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously the hate started to pour out. And one of the sort of noticeable spots was this wall in Manchester where there's an actual mural of Rashford, who's one of the three players. And I guess immediately after the game, people had gone and defaced that mural with lots of hate speech on it. And the person who made the muralist himself wanted to undo it and fix the thing. But I guess it's the UK, it was raining, and he couldn't do it that same night. So people came to the rescue, and there's this awesome image of how people have brought in little cans, post-it notes, plastic covers to make sure the post-it notes don't get washed away, and basically covered up all the hate speech, which is getting people to talk a lot about it and say how love always conquers hate. And
yes, so, that's a nice message.
Out of an awful piece of hate has come this thing.
It was so interesting because even not the obvious, very in-your-face racism that came from this, I saw someone share a headline from an Australian newspaper, and I'm sure the person who wrote it in no way assumed they were being racist, but the headline literally said, England's three black players miss penalty kicks. The fact that they had to identify that, it just shows how ingrained this kind of stuff still is in the journalistic community. Anyways, now to move on, we wanted to talk about retail. You were talking about retail traffic.
Yes. So there's some new numbers that have come out for how it is that Canadian retailers, now we've just reopened, right? It's only now allowed to go back the last couple of weeks that we've been able to go into non-essential stores and stuff.
And restaurants are opening Friday, tomorrow.
Yes.
Yeah.
So with that in mind, I think the numbers are showing that since 2019, last month had a 40% jump in retail, in-store retail shopping, which is not surprising. I think at least in Toronto and many other cities, we've been in one version of lockdown or the other since before Christmas, right? So that's a good two quarters of not shopping or not being able to touch and feel anything. So I think it's clothing and stuff in particular that are leading that, where people want to go back and how do I look in this thing before I buy it, and how not to buy three sizes and have to return them or whatever. So so that's, I think, the retail thing is picking up, which is...
Are you going to be going into a store to shop?
For food, yes, Will.
Yes.
I'm certainly going to go and want to touch some, different types of gourmet things and not have to buy the same from Walmart and blah, blah.
Yeah.
That I will be doing.
Yes. Okay, so let's move on to the next story. Oh, this one was a story probably many of you saw. This was in the New York Times, then picked up everywhere. There was a study that came out about the way we communicate at work, our preferred mode of communication. I mean, collaboration.
Yeah.
And there was a huge gap in the under 30 versus over 30. So over 30, email is one of our main tools for workplace collaboration.
Yeah.
Makes sense? Under 30, it was Google Documents and then Zoom. And they quoted a lot of the Gen Z saying, like, email gives me stress. I'd rather communicate in any way other than email. So I'm wondering, with this shift of communicating in a different way, and we are going to actually talk to someone who's
a facilitator,
and she's a big believer in those stand-ups as opposed to emailing.
Yeah.
You just meet every morning for 15 minutes and get everything unblocked and move on. So, you know, I'm sure she'd be a big supporter of that, but it's going to be interesting to see how, as this generation comes up, will email be a thing of the past soon?
I don't think it's ever going to fully go away. I just think we have to get a lot better at the way we use it, right? Mm-hmm. The way we use it right now, we copy everyone and his dog and, you know, self-indulgent, long-winded emails.
Oh, and those threads that you're trying to figure out.
Who said what? And it all nests under each other too. So yeah, definitely that sort of outdated way of using email needs to go away. But that said, I don't think email's going anywhere. I for one, I prefer text, Will. Like, if it's a short, to-the-point thing, like, text me. If it's a, like, 10-point thing, then yeah, sure, I want it somewhere where I can go back and review it. In which case, Google Docs. Like, why are we putting it on email?
Yeah, we do use Google Docs hardcore
here
at C++. And yeah, email I think is great when you have a big brief for someone or you do have to get something out, but you're so right, that unnecessary CCing people on things, and it's just,
painful. So next up is Barbie dolls. Like, as a mom of a 10-year-old, like, I have serious knowledge about dolls and, you know, far too much really. So I'm loving that Barbie over the years has sort of reinvented itself from being like a slightly objectified, you know, doll to really starting to represent people and tell stories through their dolls. The latest one is Naomi Osaka has her own Barbie now. And while this thing was commissioned a couple of years ago as part of their 50th anniversary celebrations and many things, it's actually come out now after Naomi Osaka's stuff that happened with the French Open. So this doll and the way it's positioned as, you know, giving girls the right to stand up and say what they believe in and being able to live the way they choose,
Very cool.
Think it's quite cool. So. There you go.
Released just in time for the Tokyo Olympics.
Yes,
very nice.
So the Emmys are coming up. The nominees are out. And this year, for the first year, I think streaming has overtaken cable, all sorts of other productions. I think the leading sort of nominations were for The Crown, for The Mandalorian.
Right. Okay.
You know, Ted Lasso was in there. Mm-hmm. So it seems like all of the streaming channels have managed to get their shows in there in a way that shows that the effort's being put into these streaming originals.
That is a big shift.
That's a big shift,
So
that right there is, you know, where we are, which is not surprising. Like, when I started the pandemic, I had Netflix.
Yeah.
Now.
now you have Disney.
All of the things.
Yeah. I know. Someone give me another $7 subscription a month to add to my list of 10. Because we've been so desperate for things to watch and entertain ourselves that we've just leaned into every streaming service possible. And with every Thirsty Thursday, of course, we have to talk about our podcast, The 4AM Report, which this episode just came out, 4AM, today, Thursday. What did we talk about in this week's episode?
Crisis communication. So in this week, we were talking about how, you know, there's so much heaviness in the news cycle. It's hard for businesses to decide how to communicate. And, you know, whether you're taking a stance or you're continuing with your own messaging, how to think about crisis communication, stop, drop, and roll.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you're invariably going to get a few things wrong or have a couple trolls that come your way. So learning how to master that apology, right? So that was the episode itself. That said, we're particularly excited this week, Will, because we get to do what? We get to have new images out.
Oh, that's true. Yes, we did a photo shoot with our friend and photographer, Melissa Trainer. Shout out to Melissa. And we're launching some new images, which is always fun to mix up the images. Because again, people, you're putting out your podcast, you got to think about the visual as well, because people are going to know you're doing the podcast if they're paying attention to what you're putting out, even if they're not listening to the podcast.
That's right. Yeah. And in this series, we've done a little time capsule of pandemic living and the grand reopening. So look out for those pictures. They make us happy.